Yeah, then I start right away and we may finish a little bit sooner because I'm certainly aware I'm between you and the evening event, so I try to be brief. Oh, no, not. Yeah, I'm Martin Schütte, as introduced. I'm here to talk a little bit about Ansible. This is not a complete basic introduction because I assume you're all maybe have seen it or at least know a little bit how to use it. Short, quick of hands, who uses Ansible? Ah, okay, quite a lot. And yeah, slides are obviously online. So there's also an extended version with more source code and so on. I go quickly through the concept, then focus on the modules. Generally, Ansible is current configuration management system. It's a little bit of a counterpoint towards older systems like Puppet and Chef. They try to redo some concepts. Most of them tried with a design of a radical simple implementation, where, like in Puppet, you have a computer science implementation with lots of graph, and in Ansible, you just have a list of steps, and you just go through them, and in practice, this turned out to be surprisingly useful. And so most things in Ansible are really simple, using lists and YAML and lots of Python. And because some words like server and client are very confusing, I try to stick to this official nomenclature of a controller. That's the machine that runs Ansible, and the target host, that's the server or device to be configured. And then there's this hierarchy of code with a playbook, a role, a task, and so on. And I'm focusing on a module. So just to get back into context, this is a simple playbook, where a web server and a database servers are configured, and there are lots of Ansible constructs in here, but there's actually only one module called, that's the YAM, and that's the part that I try to focus on, because that's the part where it's easiest, or the most easiest, to extend Ansible with own code, own additions, own extensions. What is a module? Even here, Ansible is really simple because they say it's some snippet of executable code. It gets some input, and it has to provide some JSON. And that's basically it. And then the next step is, where does this run? It might run on the controller or on the remote port, a remote device that's open. So these are already two completely functional Ansible modules. They don't take much of an input, or they ignore their input, but they provide valid JSON output, so they're executable as Ansible modules. If I put them into the right place, I can run this, and obviously it doesn't do very much, but it's valid. And then just to take one layer, one deeper look into the architecture. If I run Ansible and have this on the controller, then I have a whole lot of plugins. And if I really search for the functionality, then the action plugins are the ones responsible for executing that. And in this normal case, in server administration, there's just a really called normal action plugin that does an SSH connection to the target, then runs the module there, usually with Python, but not always. And then over this SSH connection takes the JSON output back. And this also the place where you would extend that to support things that are not accessible via SSH. Yeah, obviously something on Windows, but also for network devices. One nice feature of Ansible is this orchestration, because this, in this normal case, we have this target host, and there we just run the module, but we can also say it runs on the controller itself, or it runs on another host, and so this lends itself to these cluster operations, where I can say, first I configure my web servers, then I do some change in the load balancer. or first I configure my servers and then I activate the switch port or set the route and so on. This makes it still very simple in principle, but very powerful because it really helps you to implement actions that go across machines. And then we also have the difference between the simple SSH from a normal Unix, Linux world going to servers. Then we have the step toward other devices that don't support a plain SSH connection and then starting Python. They are mostly network devices and so on. Ansible started to support these and to write code for them. And the first step was to have lots of modules that then all ran on the controller. So I have this controller where I start Ansible, and then they have a local module, which, very simple case, just a command. And then this module had to SSH to the network device and to handle all credentials. This got a little bit nicer and more abstract in the newer versions, especially now with version 2.9, I've seen it. They try to normalize and standardize everything. Now there's just a CLI command that works across all major network vendors. The trick in this part is that this information, do I have an iOS device, do I have a Junos or a Juniper device, it's not gone, it's just under the hood because I have to maintain that in the inventory. And then at runtime or at the module level, Ansible will know it's this OS, it's this connection, I have to use SSH, I have to use netconf, and then it can run the command. So that was just an overview of the general architecture and where the modules are placed. If I want to implement new functionality, the first advice is maybe you don't have to. Some of the standard library modules are really powerful. There are things in there like get a URL, post data to a URL that's sometimes sufficient to access all kinds of REST APIs and web services. Then there are nice things like looping constructs, so you can wait until the service is available. Sometimes that's really useful and you don't have to write any code on your own. And it's simpler and you don't have to maintain anything. So really take a look there. But the assumption here is that I assume maybe you have some problem or some kind of device or some internal database you want to access and that just doesn't work. So what do you do now? You want to extend Ansible. And then the first step is usually to look into the standard library and look what's already there, just to see how it's implemented. I took the IPFI API because that's really simple. It's a small module written to access a public API server and get your public IP back. If you open this module, or you can look into that module on GitHub or in the Ansible standard library on your machine, you will see a Python file for it. And the first page you see is this documentation, which is also quite nice if you start writing your own. Start with the documentation. Write down what parameters do you expect and what answers do you expect to come back. It's always very useful for yourself to write that and for your users just to see what they get. Yeah, in this case, it's this API service and you can optionally define another endpoint or timeout. And once you have that, you can even create this documentation on the command line. That's also quite useful if you haven't used that on the command line, you can get documentation for all Ansible modules on the fly to look up parameters. So anyway, then you scroll down past the documentation and then you see the main part of this module. And this is a pretty standard example with the same elements you find everywhere. It's all in Python. There's this construct of a main function which just says what is the entry point, and then it uses the Ansible module as a kind of standard library because this Ansible module provides all kinds of parameter checks, output formatting, everything that you need to run in this Ansible context. Yeah, like the parameters. You declare what parameters do I expect, what data types do they have, do they have a default value. Then in the middle you have some function that actually does something, in this case the run. And then you prepare your result set and it gets back to Ansible. In the end with this helper function exit.json, you put a dictionary in, you have several attributes, and then it has to become valid JSON again for the calling controller. And then this function run, that's the interesting part there, something happens. In this case, very little happens because it's just doing an HTTP request against this API. So I don't want to get into everything here. It's mostly Python syntax around this HTTP request. But you see there's a fetch URL that does it, maybe with a different timeout. And in the end, they build this dictionary of the result, and that gets back to the server. And when you use it in your playbook or in your task, then you have this probably known YAML syntax. Everything gets put into a list of YAML tasks inside this YAML file, where you say, I want to call this module, in this case IP5facts, optionally with a parameter. And also optionally, you can register the result and do something with it. For example, just output it in a debug message. A more typical use would be write it into a configuration file, whatever you want to do with it. Yeah, and then that's a nice example because it's short and concise and you can see everything. And that's already a good boilerplate because I would say most of the standard library tools modules look the same because they have the same structure and it's mostly given by the tool. You use the standard library, you say what parameters do I get, then you have some implementation that does something. In this case, it only looked up a value. In other cases, you would perform some action, write a file, apply a configuration, and so on. And then you prepare this output directory, dictionary, so the Ansible controller and the Ansible run gets a result back. Yeah, assuming you have some small file and want to try it out, where do I put it? Ansible has a whole hierarchy of lookup places where it can find its modules. Starting from the system-wide standard library that comes with Ansible itself, up onto the current directory if you run it interactively and set a module path. But in my experience, the most natural place is inside a role, because I usually have a playbook that configures a whole application or cluster, and inside that there are roles for maybe web server, database servers, network devices. And that's usually the right place because that's some kind of topic and some application it has to talk to, and then there's a custom function in there with a module. So inside every role, or if you want to also inside every playbook, there can be a library folder, and inside that library subdirectory all these modules are, and the file name determines the module name. And if you use some helper libraries, they all can go into module utils. That's also a special directory. Everything in module utils can be used in this in Python import. So if you run on a remote target host, then that gets packaged and sent to the target host. So these are the libraries you can use. If I have some utillib there, and I do this import utillib, then that works across all devices that run this Python code. And then I have this standard library. I also already mentioned the parameters obviously have to be declared there. It has some nice functions around this JSON generation. You generally don't have to worry about any JSON formatting or nesting or so, because you only take the Python variables and call the exit.json, fail.json with your dictionary. And some functions that are nice because they are operating system specific, something like an atomic file move. There are incredibly large numbers of parameters depending on operation system or even distribution version, what you have to do to really move a file, and that's all abstracted away in the standard library, or also to run a command just on the shell. So that's really helpful. So you don't have to program that much, but you only have to express what you want to achieve and maybe move a bash script into a Python module. That helps. And then the most important pattern for everything we do here with the configuration management is the item potency, which just says don't change the system unless it needs to be changed. The general steps are always check if the result, the desired result state is already there. If it's already in the desired state, then don't do anything. Only if there's a change needed, then apply the change. This leads to some nice properties. First, obviously, is you usually shouldn't do anything. The second nice property is you can also use the configuration as a kind of monitoring. You can just run it, and if it doesn't change anything, then your configuration is in the same state as it should be, and nobody has changed it manually or intervened or whatever causes a configuration to change. And because that is so useful, there's also a check mode where you can run Ansible and just tell it, don't change anything, but report to me if changes would be necessary. That's also something you have to implement in your own module if you want to support that. You will get a special flag inside this Ansible module, and then you can decide what to do with this situation. This is an example from the hostname module, which updates your server hostname. And there you can see these two steps. First, it checks if anything has to be done. So if the present name is unlike the specified name. And if that's the case, then something should be done. And then there's a check for the check mode. So if the check mode is active, then it just reports, I would change this name if I was allowed to, and exits. And if the check mode is not active, then it will actually do the change and perform and apply the new host name. That's also something you will find in every present module, or in most of them. Not every module supports the check mode, but it's really advisable to implement it if you write a new module. It just helps everybody who uses the system. Yeah, and then there are common return values that are always there. This return dictionary has several attributes and entries, and the things like changed and failed are somewhat necessary. You don't have to set them, but in that case, Ansible will just assume there was a change, and depending on the process exit code, it says it's failed or not. Everything else is optional, but it's always useful, if it applies to the module, of course. You don't have a backup file if there is no file operation and so on, but those are the things where there's good support in the playbooks and so on. Yeah, some have special use. You can set facts with Ansible facts and so on, special one for exceptions and so on, but I guess you see those when you need them. Something that is quite nice is the ability to diff some values, even for things that are not files. This, again, is from the hostname module, where it's just easier in the output. Even if you run Ansible on the command line, you get a nice diff formatted, or if you run it inside of Jenkins or Ansible Tower, just as a user, you see what changed. And if you have something with lots of attributes, like a database entry, it's easy to this diff format makes it easy to see what changed and what isn't. So I really advise to use it. Yeah, this set facts is another nice thing because one module never works really on its own. There are always some steps that gather information around about the system, and then other modules, other tasks, use this information to do something, to write configuration, to skip tasks or not. And with this facts, you just gather information about a host, if it's a host name or memory and so on. Also interesting, you can't do everything with the Python standard library. Sometimes you have to import other Python modules, and then it's always useful to tell the administrator what part is missing if it's not there. If I don't have a PostgreSQL library installed, I can't do anything with the database. So I at least want to give a clear error message why this isn't working. If something doesn't work as expected, there are some useful tools to get forward. Something that I found most useful was to run everything in a Vagrant, because it really speeds up this cycle of writing something, testing it out, see if it works or if it doesn't. Even more so, if you try to support multiple distributions or variations, then having it in a local, on your local machine in virtual machines makes everything simpler and easier than having it with remote machines where everything takes time. The verbose mode is always useful up to a point. With too many verbose flags, you see all the SSH commands in detail, and you should not need them. If there's a problem with the SSH connection, then that's really useful, but for all logic errors inside the modules, that's just too much overhead, and you just can't read the logs. Well, you see. Inside the module, you can't just print to standard out, because it's expected to be in JSON. So the best way around that is just to add another entry in this result, because that's a dictionary. You can put in there whatever you want, and to get a flag, maybe you just add another attribute. And maybe remove it later when you release the module to the public, but to test things out, that's the easiest and the quickest way. There's a log, but that goes to the local syslog on the target host and not onto the controller, so it varies if it's useful or not. And likewise, for in Python, there's a pretty cool library called q, which writes a file tempq. That's also very useful because you can somewhat trace the Python programs. But like the syslog, it's on the target host, it's not on the controller, so you still have to log into the target host to see any output. Yeah, beyond Python, the initially reason that I considered this topic was to have modules in other languages, but I really have to say I found out it's not very useful. Ansible does support other scripting languages, and you can even put binaries into this library folder and they get executed, but it's not really practical. You miss out all the standard library support if you don't use Python. You all have to implement most of it yourself with JSON libraries and check all the values. That's really a lot of additional work. And with binaries, that may theoretically work if all your target hosts have the same architecture, the same operating system, the same libraries. But as soon as there are any variants, that will break. So in that case, I would really advise to use operating system packages. So package it as a Debian package, RPMs, whatever, and install the tool on the machine, and then just run a small wrapper around it. You don't want binary executables in your Ansible Git repository. Yeah, and that brings me to the conclusion. This is all pretty much centered around Linux-like target hosts, things that you can SSH in, and then have a Python interpreter to run your modules. So that's mostly the setting for this. And in that case, it's really easy to get your own Python code written and deployed and then run with Ansible. And I would put out the hypothesis that everybody who can write non-trivial shell scripts with maybe 100 lines can also write the same code in Python. It's not that easy. This is not really deep dive software engineering with classes and object orientation, but it's basically just scripts. So one can learn this quite easily and then use these modules to get own functionality into Ansible. I think that is pretty cool. On the other hand, I also looked into the network device automation with Ansible and found out this is certainly a level up on that. They have two or three layers of abstraction in there just to handle all the different connections and terminals. So that's not as straightforward. So it's certainly interesting to see how that is implemented. And I would say it's probably possible to add some flag to another command, but without Python development experience, it's a little bit hard to get into. Yeah, something else I discovered, Ansible is really quickly developing. I've looked into Ansible for basically three major projects with it, and that was several years ago in version 1.8, and about 2 years ago with version 2.3, and now for this with the new release 2.9, and everything, major things changed, like loop variables, like this whole plugin infrastructure. And as always, it's a double-sided coin. On the one hand, it's really nice to see how things improve, how things get easier to use and more logically structured. But on the other hand, you can never say, I wrote this Ansible playbook and now it's done and I don't have to touch it for 10 years. In practice, that doesn't work. It does need some maintenance, even if you say only every 2 years or so, I update it to the current Ansible version. And the project itself realized that and introduced these maintenance levels, where they clearly stated this is supported by core. There's a special layer for network devices because they require vendor support for many things. Yeah, and then the certified, I think that's for partners and Red Hat support, and then just the community where they say we can't support everything, but it's on GitHub. Yeah, a few links if you want to dig deeper into this. I found out this module writing part is not as well covered in the documentation as I would wish. Most of it is in this convention tips and pitfalls article. That's really useful, but only after you encountered this pitfall and then want to read on it. This book is pretty good because it's the only one I saw that does cover module writing, but it's also for Ansible 2.3. It's still current, but not for the latest version. Yeah, and since we're at DNOC, they do have a special network working group. They document everything they do quite openly in a GitHub wiki. I found that really interesting, although most of it doesn't apply to the things that I implement myself with Python, but they have a completely different topic with supporting all these devices, all these vendors, all these interfaces. But still very useful, especially if you want to find out what actions are supported on your device. So, yeah, and that's it. And maybe we have some time for questions.